3.5 years ago, I left Berlin by impolite request of the Nazi government. I thought it was a pretty crummy city that I gladly bade farewell to then. Yesterday, I went back. I went back to report on the Nazi capitulation to the Red Army and to us in the headquarters of Marshal Zhukov. But however great and important that historic event was, the thing that left me and all the other correspondents speechless before we ever reached the Marshal's headquarters was the sight of Berlin. It's still hard to make myself believe that it wasn't some dream. The city I knew is gone, rubbed out. It's the most massive work of concentrated destruction in history. I made a tour of Berlin this morning. It was a tour I shall never forget. What made this tour all the more interesting is that we went with men who did it. Air Chief Marshal of the RAF, Sir Arthur Tedder, and the Commander of America's Strategic Bombing Forces, General Carl Spatz. These two men, more than anybody else, have for 3 and 4 years planned and executed the annihilation of Berlin. Today, for the first time, they saw the results from the ground. They stood before the Reichstag and the Chancellery and the ruins of Unter den Linden, and they said nothing. There were no words capable of encompassing that vast scene of desolation. Perhaps the best general impression I've heard expressed was that of a fellow correspondent who watched the wastelands that were once the Tiergarten Park for several minutes silently and then said, "It takes your breath away." Before landing at Tempelhof Airfield yesterday, we circled over the city twice. It's, generally speaking, the center of Berlin which has been truly flattened. For block after block and mile after mile of avenues and streets, there's nothing but roofless, hollow hulls of houses. Out around the fringes of town, the houses with their roofs still on become more numerous. But now and then, even out there, you run across a block that has literally been wiped out. Berlin was, in numbers of population, the fourth largest city in the world. In area, it's the second largest. The center of the town is a vast oval. The Wilhelmstrasse, the government street, runs from the perimeter straight into Unter den Linden in the very middle of the city. We tried to get to the middle by following it this morning, but we couldn't. Rubble is so deep that in some places you couldn't even tell that a street had once been there. So we took a devious route to the center, twisting and winding through valleys of ruins. But the place was not just ruined. The ruins themselves had been pounded, then repounded and repounded, until there's no more rubble of bricks and parts of bricks. All there is left is dust, fine, powdery, pale red dust that you can sink down to the hubcaps in. The car ahead of us was just 50 yards away, and it was moving slowly. But it churned up so much dust that we couldn't see it. We had to tie handkerchiefs around our noses and mouths to keep the brick dust out. All over town, houses were still smoldering. Some of the fires were fresh fires, just begun by time bombs left behind in the ruins by the Nazis. The Russians said a few went off every day. An hour after we had arrived at Tempelhof Airfield, the main administration building of the airdrome burst into flame from one of these mines, and it burned all through the night. After a long, twisting ride through desolate streets, our convoy stopped at what appeared in the dim outlines of the wreckage to have been once a large traffic circle. I got out and tried to orient myself, but there was nothing familiar. There was a sign there in Russian. After a little while, I made out the Cyrillic letters. This was Alexanderplatz, one of the main and best-known intersections toward the center of Berlin. I got my bearings from a cleared street and was able to pick out in the rubble the notorious Gestapo prison. Once Dick Hottolet, an American war correspondent, had been locked there, and I had tried vainly to visit him. It was a massive red brick structure then. Now it was chewed down to a nub of a foundation, and the bricks were black with soot. On the corner there had been, I remembered, an enormous 18 feet high bronze statue of buxom Berolina, the patron goddess of Berlin. There was nothing but the pedestal left now. Berolina herself was just so much shattered and half-molten scrap. From there we made our way to the direct center. I kept my eyes open for domes and towers, old familiar landmarks to guide us, but there were none. The skyline was a jagged silhouette. No section of it different from any other section. I know that part of Berlin as well as I know my own bedroom. but I didn't recognize any of it without having to think back and from familiar patches of familiar buildings try and reconstruct it in my mind. We stopped at Kaiser Wilhelm's massive palace at the east end of Unter den Linden. Its roof had been raked off as if by a gigantic knife. Its front portico, where the people of Berlin heard from Kaiser Wilhelm the joyous news that the First World War had broken out, was a steep hill of wreckage. The Lustgarten, the big square out in front of the palace, where Hitler used to stage his big open-air demonstrations, was plowed with craters. On Unter den Linden, the famous broad thoroughfare that divides Berlin into northern and southern halves, it was a silent valley of empty, crushed hulls of houses. All the hideous old architectural monuments to Prussianism, the old arsenal where Hitler used to speak once a year on Heroes Memorial Day, the State Opera House, the University, the famous cafes and the embassies were complete, indistinguishable ruins. The Adlon Hotel, where Hitler and Ribbentrop used to lodge visiting heads of state, had been provisionally picked out as a press headquarters, should American correspondents ever set up in Berlin again. We had been told it was virtually intact. Well, it isn't. Only three of its six or seven floors remained, and they were burnt black inside. About the only landmark that was still up and recognizable was the Brandenburg Gate at the west end of Berlin. Its pillars were gashed and broken. On top of it, the bronze statue of Victoria in her horse-drawn chariot of triumph was distorted and mangled, but you could still orient yourself by it. Beyond the gate is the Tiergarten, the vast park of central Berlin. Once it was a beautiful forest park. Today it looks like nothing so much as parts of the famous Hürtgen Forest south of Aachen, where American and German troops fought one of the bitterest battles of the war for months. The trees were chewed, twisted trunks without branches or leaves. The earth was plowed with craters. The Nazis tried to make a last stand in the Tiergarten, and they and their once lovely park were chewed to shreds. We went down the Wilhelmstrasse from Unter den Linden. Ribbentrop's bright yellow foreign office was black. Through its windows, you could see daylight on the other side. The propaganda ministry is literally leveled. We stopped at Hitler's chancellery, the enormous, supposedly bomb-proof center from which a decade of history has been dictated. At the front door, there was a bomb crater big enough to hide a truck in. Symbolically, half of a geographic globe, slightly battered and with bullet holes in it, lay at the bottom of the crater. It had belonged to Hitler. He probably inflamed his imagination for purposes of global strategy by considering it back in the old days. The Russians had found it in his study and had thrown it out of the window into the crater. The bomb-proof chancellery was, like so many other Nazi creations, a myth. There were yawning holes in the ceiling. One crater, right inside the entrance of the great marble hall, reached deep down through two floors of the cellar. A bronze bust of Hitler with a bullet hole through its forehead lay in the dusty ruins down in the cellar. The Führer's garden had apparently been fought for, too. There was not a patch of green on its pocked, scarred surface. General Sokolovsky, deputy commander to Marshal Zhukov, who had come with us on the trip, said the body of Goebbels and his wife and children had been found here. We asked about Hitler's body. The general smiled and said at least six bodies of Hitler had been offered to the Red Army by Germans. None of them were in recognizable state. It was hard to believe that this scarred wreck was the famed headquarters of Hitler. In fact, it was and it is still hard to believe that it was Berlin I saw. It's like something out of a distorted dream. In the valleys of ruin, we saw not a single German. It was hard to believe that human beings had ever lived here. The parts of Berlin that were not badly beaten seemed to be more Russian than German. There were Russian signs all over the streets, Russian vehicles, and red flags. There were Russian soldiers and Russian civilians attached to the army on all the streets. What remained of Berlin seemed to have altered its nationality and its atmosphere. The pervasive and unmistakable odor of Russian gasoline added to the illusion. Now, right in the middle of the map of Berlin, in the Tiergarten, a monument is being erected. It was half finished this morning when we passed. It's a tribunal of many columns, and in Russian characters on each column is printed the name of a Nazi victim: Austria, Czechoslovakia, Norway, Denmark, and so on. It's a monument to the United Nations, and it's Russian. Berlin, the Prussian capital, with a Prussian atmosphere thick enough to cut, no longer exists. I don't know what to call the ruined city I saw today, but it was not Berlin.